Well, I define it essentially as the use of digital technology to both represent and analyze historical information. So simply put, another way to talk about it is to talk about the transformation of all of the historical documents as well as analyses from atoms to bits. In other words, we're moving everything from one platform to another. But it's both for representation and analysis, as people have said. My main focus right now really is information technology and black studies. And I find that we have a lot of work to do, both within the discipline of black studies, as well as the relationship between the discipline and the administration of the institutions, and as well, I might add, of the professional organizations. So there's a learning curve. We have to speed up one. I think that people are still in the wow stage, as opposed to show me how to do it stage. I think that we're moving into the use of what exists as curriculum materials. And so there's going to be, I think, in the long run, a greater impact on people who are students now, who are beginning to see this as simply a legitimate source of information and a legitimate way of doing things. So there is that generational hope I have. But other than the curriculum use, there is the use of digital products or digital projects to inform research that is not digital. So it's like people say, oh yes, I found this new resource, but it's not the resource that they're going to then emulate, but they're simply a new resource they're going to use. So there's a utility factor there. And that's why we say in black studies, it's important to also keep the black community into some perspective because of the term the digital divide. And, and what we're thinking now is that the real digital divide is not access, the way in which it's been talked about. And that is to say downloading, it's uploading. It's getting people to create digital representation of the data that they're dealing with. And that is something we're still very much working on. Well, it's very interesting because there is a long history of that level of campus community scholar population cooperation pre-digital age. So there's a lot of collaboration in the history. W. Du Bois conferences in Atlanta, for example, were based on questionnaires that he sent out to the graduates of Atlanta University. They gathered the data, came to the conference, and collectively they analyzed the data and then produced a report. Monroe Work in Tuskegee did the great collection of data around lynching by having graduates of Tuskegee send in newspaper accounts from all over the South. So there's a lot of that sort of collaboration. What is the crisis point is having the level of accountability and transparency that breaks down the feudal moat around the campus. And that is the, it's a crisis of, you know, it's part of the change. The other thing that I think is important here is the question of proprietary nature of things. That unfortunately, the academic profession has become intensely entrepreneurial. And so we produce commodities, books and things we sell. And we've even disguised it, and the university disguises it. So the tenure is often based on how good of an entrepreneur you are, and not independently the evaluation of your scholarship. In other words, it's have you produced the book, not have you produced the scholarship. And the book is a commodity. And so the notion of digital is also very much tied to the notion of the commons that we're creating. So digital history is the reproduction of a commons of knowledge that everyone can have access to. This is challenging the entrepreneurial aspect of what we do, and that's going to have a profound impact, and that hasn't really happened yet. So we're still kind of struggling with the petty commodity mode of thinking as opposed to the collective production of a commons for all of us. Well, I think what's happening is that a whole parallel structure is developing. So on one hand, for example, you have people in Black Studies producing encyclopedias that are books. There's sort of an encyclopedia moment. And if you go to Greenwood Press or any of these presses that do the encyclopedias, it's all over the place. But parallel to that, you have Wikipedia. And you have the development of free digital tools. And I think that, even in terms of, say, Africa, where you have now wikis in African languages. So the idea of what's good, so there are two parallel structures. And I think they're going to compete for a while. And they're going to be a group of people, particularly as libraries continue to buy these encyclopedias, because that's really their audience, versus purchase these or create these free digital environments in which knowledge is produced and shared. I see a period, the next period ahead is a period of competing platforms, the proprietary imprint versus the commons, the digital commons. My money's on the commons. That's all I can say. There are upsides and downsides to digitizing the past. In the sense that, do we represent the past, or do we intervene in the past based upon what we know today? So for example, if Google and then other digitization projects, Gutenberg, so on, go into the library and the archives and you digitize all this material, is it necessary to think about digitizing the anecdote to some of the ridiculous information that paraded as scholarship? If you take a library and you digitize everything that it has from the 19th and early 20th centuries, that's not going to provide a very happy and accurate reflection, say, on the Black experience or on the experience of women. So the Google project is wonderful, but if you don't simultaneously digitize the collection of the Schoenberg in New York or the Vivian Harsh collection in Chicago, then you're really bringing back a past that is flawed, to say the least. I think this is a serious problem, and we're trying to address it in Black Studies. Mm-hmm. So the wonderful intentions of digital reproduction of the past is fraught with danger, and we have to be very, very careful that we don't end up making the worst in American history a click away, and its anecdote still under copyright.
Well, then, should we look at these big projects as things that are interesting because of making information available, but they need to have scholarly mediation to their presentation, or make them a broader institutional project and have the library, but then, as you said, have other collections that represent a fuller look at different life experiences combined? I know that's in some ways that's impossible, but is there a way to mediate these big projects?
No, I think both are important. Mm-hmm. In other words, if, for example, you were to take Mark Twain's analysis of the riverboat captain and use that to discuss the Mississippi without looking at William Wells Brown's autobiography as a slave who was on the Mississippi River. And therefore, what you've got is two perspectives on the same experience, and they can interrogate each other. That, it seems to me, is what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. But if you only have that one side, or that European person on the deck of a boat looking over into the slave field, writing about how slaves are happy and they're singing and they're working hard and everything seems to be going okay, or whatever that story was, without figuring out how to get that slave's point of view, then it's flawed. And so when I see this wonderful attempt to digitize these libraries, where they're measuring the skulls of Black people to rationalize, cranial size means stage of evolution, and you don't have anybody talking about how ridiculous that is, or you don't have Google's, you know, critique of it or something. Mm-hmm. I mean, what are we doing when we allow students, enable students, mm-hmm. click and go to that other information, but we don't have any indication, you know, that this is totally fallacious and only interesting as an example of, you know, some time in history which hopefully will never be reproduced again. And yet we're reproducing it digitally, and if we don't have some way of indicating to people what the subsequent scholarship or critique or at simultaneously what the other view was of that, mm-hmm. then I think we're going to have unintended consequences.